explorer, filmmaker. What's next? Is there another new Avatar?
Well, we're gonna make two more Avatar films. I guess my most powerful motivation for that, other than you know, obviously we've got a huge fan base now, is that the films had this interesting effect around the world. They made a lot of money, but they made money in a way that I actually found really inspired hope in me, because people were connecting with the message of connectedness with each other. You know, I see you, connectedness with nature. And there was this huge outpouring of interest from environmental groups, NGOs, nonprofits that were involved in indigenous rights and so on, that came to me wanting to be involved somehow, you know, asked me if they could help use Avatar, not to further our message, but to further their message. And I thought, okay, you know, that's fair enough. You know, we've managed to get the eyeballs. We've got people thinking about this film. Why not use it to focus a spotlight on some very specific issues? And that's why we went down to the Amazon and got involved in some of the indigenous rights issues there. Went up to Canada to the tar sands and did a little fact-finding expedition up there. And have gotten more involved in a lot of these causes. I mean, I was always involved, you know, as a kind of a lay, you know, environmentalist. Now I'm much more involved. The incentive to make the second and third Avatar film is that I think we can continue to do good. We can do well, and we can do good as we're doing well. And I certainly would encourage anybody, and I would challenge anybody, given the state of the world as it might be if we're not careful, to try to find ways to be entrepreneurs and be innovative and be inventive, funnel all that towards something that also is going to be good for the planet and for our children, for future generations.
Yeah. Do you find yourself caught in suddenly, you've talked about something that a lot of people relate to, a lot of NGOs relate to, etc., and suddenly they feel you are their spokesperson. Do you get caught up in things where a lot of people who know you feel they're your friend, where you may or may not know about everything that's going on with them?
Yeah, it's tricky, because the first thing I say, and I, you know, I said this with respect, you know, when people came to me about the issues that were happening in the Amazon with the hydroelectric projects that are displacing people, you know, they wanted me to just stand up and start yelling about it. And I said, I'm not going to do that. You know, the same thing with the tar sands in Canada. I said, I need to go there, I need to talk to people, and I need to talk to people on all sides of the issue. And when I feel informed and passionate about it, then I can be a spokesman. And maybe that'll lead to a documentary film, maybe it'll just lead to some kind of media campaign, you know, kind of direct action where we just talk directly to the public. And that's what we actually did. But I felt once I was informed, then I could be a spokesperson. So I have to pick these battles carefully. I can't just be kind of firing in all directions.
Yeah. And so after digital domain, I mean, you're doing a lot of work in technology. Mm-hmm. Do you have any thoughts of doing another technology company per se? Are you thinking of converting any, you know, all the things that you're doing into a company?
Well, I'm very interested in renewable energy, because I think that really, you know, what happens in the next 10 to 15 years on a global level is really going to be determined by energy. And energy startups, our transition to renewables, how we incorporate that into our various economies around the world, how we incorporate it into the way governments manifest their energy strategies. So I want to do something in that sector. It's not clear exactly what that's going to be yet, but I'm going to put some of my own resources into that and really focus, you know, my extracurricular energy outside of Avatar. Although in my mind it all relates, because Avatar is really about as a series of films, is really about the collision between, you know, rapidly developing technological civilization and what it's doing to the natural world and the, you know, indigenous people who are in a sense representatives of that natural world. And we're not going to solve the environmental crisis, which is ahead of us, which is really being driven by rapid climate change, if we don't solve our energy problems.
Yeah. So you've come a long way from being a person from Canada starting out in the world to where you are now. How do you define success for you? What is success to you?
I guess success is when people are listening, and there's some measurable change in consciousness worldwide, even if the needle barely moves. You know, I think that if you're communicating ideas and telling stories, if the feedback is that those seeds are landing on fertile soil, that's success. I think, you know, I would say I felt that even more with Avatar than with Titanic. Titanic, we definitely we moved people for a couple of hours, and they cried, and then they left, and that was that. You know, Avatar is a different story because it lingered with them, and you know, dare I say, maybe even to some tiny degree may influence their perspective on how we're behaving with respect to the natural world and basically the destruction that we're causing.
Yeah, you know, last time when you were here, we had the chance to go to Haridwar. I told Jim that you need to see the India that I want to show you, not just the party India. So we went to Haridwar during Kumbh Mela time, where there is thousands of holy men there, and you know, nobody knew who you were.
Oh, it was
so what was that like?
It was a wonderful day. We couldn't even get close to Haridwar.
Right.
And I think we had to park, you know, 4 or 5 miles away. And we walked in, and I think for 7 hours or so, we didn't see anybody but the pilgrims. And we just kind of wandered along, and they didn't know who we were and didn't care, you know. Yeah. And in the midst of all the kind of whirlwind around Avatar and the world tour and all the photo ops and all that, it was really nice to be, you know, just kind of anonymous and to just be in this place and kind of soaking in what everybody was there to do, quite literally, because we went to the Ganga and purified ourselves and so on.
So he did take a dip in the...
I did.
We were the only two who dared to, you know, go all the way down.
She was more hesitant than I was, which I probably should have thought about what that meant.
Because I know what there, you didn't.
I knew, but after walking 7 hours in the heat, forget it. I was going in the damn river.
So do you think the cleansing in the Ganga has helped you in any way in your life?
I don't know. You know, I mean, I think what it is, for me as a non-Hindu, it just allows me to share a little bit of that, you know, that belief system for a moment and think about what that means, what it means to all those, you know, to all those people that were all around me. Yeah. And you do feel something. You do feel something that's ancient. The more experiences I think people can have that connect them somehow to ancient wisdom, the better off we're all going to be. I don't think wisdom, you know, I don't think you can find wisdom on the internet. You got to find it somewhere else. I think you can get information. And I think people really need to know the difference between the two. Yeah.
So, what, you know, you also run Muse School with your wife, Susie. And what are the things you would like to teach children? If you feel there are certain things we must teach our children, what would they be?
Muse is founded on the ideas of it's a very small school. It's an elementary school that my wife founded, but it's founded on principles of in a way making the teachers better, so that the teachers respond to the specific needs of kids as individuals, as they all learn in different ways. And obviously, education is the key to anything that we're going to do to try to, you know, to keep our civilization afloat in this century, which is going to be a very challenging century. And so, you know, it's teaching the kids, you know, stewardship of the earth, respect for nature, understanding of it, respect for science, not for superstition, but for science as a way of understanding the truth of the natural world, respect for each other, respect for themselves, you know, conflict resolution. You know, kids go through all of the things, you know, that we're going to go through for the rest of their lives. Give them the tools to work in social settings, to work as teams, but to be empowered as individuals. And on all of that, those social skill building, you know, and her school does all of those things. And they go out and work in the organic garden every morning or every other morning, so they understand where their food comes from. And really, there's so many people around the world, probably less so here, but there's certain, you know, in urban settings around the world where people are disconnected from their food supply. They don't even know where it comes from. Food comes from the supermarket. Well, food doesn't come from the supermarket, you know. And you need to know what's in it, and you need to respect the soil, because our soils are being destroyed. The food we eat is mostly bad for us. you know, and we're running out of arable land, and you know, all of the problems that confront us are going to be about understanding the natural cycles better, as individuals, as every individual, not displacing it off to the scientists and to government to deal with it, but everybody kind of understanding it in an organic way.
Yeah. So I have to ask you this question. I read somewhere, and I don't know if it's true or not. I keep reading it, that you were once a truck driver. Is that true?
That's absolutely correct. I was a truck driver. I was a bus mechanic. I was a precision tool and die machinist until my tools got stolen. And then I had to go become a film director.
On that note, we are really glad you became a film director to give us a lot of entertainment and also a way to travel within ourselves. And I think, to me, Avatar was truly a visually spectacular movie that also took me into myself in a very different way.
Thank you.
So I know how many things pull you. How do you, my interest, obviously, you know, there is an underlying selfish interest in here that I would love to see you work with India, with an Indian story, with something in a huge way, because I think when you're inspired by something about India, the way you would show it would be very different than how any of us would show it. So I hope that...
Well, put me down for right after the third Avatar movie. But in the meantime, if there are Indian, Indian director or producer that would want to pursue a project like that would use the types of tools that we've already developed, whether it's the 3D systems or the virtual camera, you know, virtual production pipeline, if they want to do that to realize something fantastic like the Mahabharata, the Ramayana, something like that, some classic story, I'd be more than happy to work with them to help achieve that.
Great. So thank you very much for giving us an insight into the scientist and the explorer and the conservation person in you.
Thank you.